open competitions is a financial experience. So you want stock or you want shares from companies, there's no difference from others. So many customers can access to one type of some financial instrument, no difference. And pre-sales auditoriums are other type of perfect competition.
Too big, they can buy the other firms.
So yes, that's one of the reasons. If the firms has enough market power, they can merge other firms into and the firm becomes the industry. That's another reason, yes. What may be other reason? Let's do about the scale of the firm, the market power of the firm. If they are powerful enough, they can merge others' enterprise and become the sole enterprise operating in the market or taking the roles of the monopoly. So what can be another cause?
Market is too new, a company might have a new idea.
Oh yes, a new idea, so invention, okay? So innovation, or something like patent. Yes, so that's right. So a firm can create something new, and they just say, take the situation of the roles of the monarchy, they will be the only one. It will be the only one to provide us products and services. Can you give an example of this type of monarchy? That one firm creates something new? It's hard to feel like that in practical. When they create something new, they go to the authority agency. Yes, to maybe the department of right and intellectual property right. Okay? And they register for their inventions or their innovation. And then the agency of intellectual property rights will help them to protect their product. And thus the protections in practice normally take 5 years. And after that, when the 5 year expire, other firms can they go to the market, go enter the market and share the market share the market with them. And to break the situations of monopoly of the firm with the invention. Okay? So just give me an example. Maybe Microsoft, okay? They create a software and it's and we have no other enterprise who is safe. That's why they won't keep those situations of monopoly. Or another example. Assume that you will create your doctor, pharmaceutical. Yes, in pharmaceutical field, if you can create a type of medicines like a medicine for treating cancer. Okay? You register with the Ministry of Health, okay? And they will help you to protect the product. That's a monopoly. Anyone who has, for example, lung cancer, want to be treated well, they will access to you to get and at the time. You can set a high price of the product to get the monopoly price. Okay, so these are some features of monopolies. So one firm or so firms and focus the industry. And then we have a unique product or no close substitution. So we are all the monopoly is the only ones providing the product or providing the service in the markets. And market entry and access difficult or legally impossible. So in the case the firm is established from the government's regulation, legal barrier makes impossible for others to come in. And non-price competitions not necessary. Some monopoly, some examples of monopoly, we have a pharmaceuticals, yes, like medicine for cancer treatment. And we have like a software like Microsoft or gas stations on the edge of desert. No one competes with you as this task as this location. So become the monopoly. So you see that? It depends on the way we define the market. So if we define the market or determine our market of operation is narrow or is broad, we can become monopoly easier or harder. Another type of market structure, that's monopolistic competition. So the competition is the main point here, and with some monopolistic characteristic. And market power may based on the products differentiation. And we still have large numbers of small firms and acting independently. It means this characteristic is quite the same as characteristic of one of competitive market of large number of buyer and seller. And we have a differentiated product. This feature is different from competitive market, because for competitive markets we have a standardized product. So on this market, each firm try to make them stand out by make some features, new features or unique feature of their product. So differentiated product. And the market entry and exit relatively easy. Not freely like the competitive markets, but quite easy. And non-price competition is very important. You can see, these are some examples of monopolistic competition. Restaurants. Each restaurant or each facility segment, they will provide theirs a list of these cuisines in as our dishes in their menu, and they are different about the diversity and different about the taste of each dishes. Our repair shops is another example of monopolistic competition. So, I think there are two features that are quite important for this monopolistic competition. So first of all, the differentiated product, and the second is about the numbers of buyers and sellers, so a large number. And the last type is the oligopoly. Oligopoly includes a group of firms that dominate the market, and product can be differentiation or not. So it's not a constraint or strict constraints for oligopoly. So these are four characteristics of oligopoly. First, small numbers of large, mutual, independent firms. And for others, chapters about the game series. So game series mostly applies in this type of markets, oligopoly. Yes. And different stages of standardized product. If they make the products differentiated, it's one way, and another way is in the case they use a standardized product. So it's mostly based on the firm's dominance of the market. And so market entry and exit is typical, not impossible, but it's quite difficult. And non-price competition is important. Some example of oligopoly, you can see in Vietnam, aviation. Yes, it's the fields of oligopoly. You may list some big firms in the market, like Vietnam Airlines or Vietjet. Yes, or Bamboo. Yes, so that's they will comprise of oligopoly. They compete and they cooperate with each other to share the market. Not only competing with each other, but they have to cooperate with each other, and they also others competitors and strategy to carry out their strategies to share the first to share the market. Our processed food or internet access for Vietnam, we have communication industry, and list some of the big names like Viettel, market reach hazard and they form a type of market that's ongoing. So that's a summary of the four types of market characteristics. First, we will focus on the quite common market, as we mentioned above, that can be shown in the agricultural market industry or financial instrument. That's perfect competition. And for any firm, they have for perfect competition. So one of the aspect particular characteristic is a large number of buyer and seller. So their basis business decisions is entering the market or basic tactics from the market. And if they decide to enter the market, these are the questions they have to answer. First, how much should they produce? How much to produce? And if produce such amount, how much profit, how can they earn? Now, how to find the profit maximization? Just to recall our last lesson. The conditions or the requirements of our profit maximization is
MR equals MC.
Yes, MR equals MC. Yes. So when measured crossovers equal measured revenue, according to our best area of maximization. And maximization not only refers to the highest level of profit, but sometimes is to minimize their loss. Yes, sometimes is to maximize their profit, and sometimes is to minimize their loss. So that's the conditions for maximization. Then, by the way, because what is the condition for maximization of revenue? Output of revenue maximization. It means any additional product will not bring us any additional revenue.
MR equals zero.
Zero, okay. So that's when, as the point, the levels of output, that marginal revenue equals zero. In nature, the conditions of marginal revenues equal marginal cost, MRS equal MC, is to maximize profit because at that point, marginal profit equal zero. Okay? And so back to the perfect competitive market. You will see if they produce such an amount, how much profit will the firm earn? And if also rather than the profit incurred, this will be worthwhile to continue this market in the long run, or should we exit? So they have to decide, in the case of earning profit, what amount of product will give them the profit of maximum profit. And in the case of loss, they have to answer the question, will they continue through the markets or they exist with the markets? And if you remember last lesson, you already have an answer for this question. These are some key assumptions of perfectly competitive market. So first, the firm is the price maker. And for monopoly, for the late price to rural health conditions, the first assumption is that the monopoly is the price taker. And for competitive markets, the firm is the price taker. It means when you enter a market, the price of the market, how much the price of the products, you can't only sell your product at that price. You can't sell your product at a higher price. Because why you can't provide your products at high price in the competitive market? Why can't you provide the market at higher price than the market's price? Set the price, you'll want to set it as high as you can. But for the competitive markets, it's impossible. You're just the price taker. Because if you set the price, your price higher than market's price, how your customer behave?
They will buy
Yes, they will shift their choice. They will turn from your firm to another firm. Because one of the particular features of this market, that's the large number of buyer and seller. So large number of buyers and selling the same product, similar product. Yes, we have standardized product. It means they can easily shift to another sellers and they can buy the same product. So they have no incentive to buy your product at high price. So you only can set your price, the maximum price at the market's price level. So will you set a lower price for the market when entering the market? Do you have an incentive to set lower price?
You want to set the low price, you need to calculate the cost.
Yes. Yes. So if you set a lower price, you will lost your machineries, it reduced your machinal profit, and you have no incentive to do that because there are many other buyers in the market and they accept the price. So the market's price, and you have no incentive to general encouragement for setting higher or lower price in the market, and so you only accept the taken price, the given price in the market. And the firm makes the distinctions between the short run and the long run. You remember the decisions in the short run and in the long run. So for the short run, the decisions will be continue or yes or exit the market. But for the long run, this will be the decision like yes, enter this or others industry. Okay, so continues or shut down. Yes, and for the long term is to enter or exit from the market. So for the short term is to continue or shut down. And for the later ones, we will find the shutdown points of the firm in the competitive market. And the firm's objective is to maximize its profit or sometimes minimize loss in the short run. And the firm increased its optimal cost of operating in a particular market is the total cost of production. So optimistic cost, it means first time you make the differentiation between the decisions of a manager and the decisions of an accountant. And for economics profit, you will consider both implicit and explicit cost, okay? So for the firms in looking in the market of competition, competition, they will consider all this type of cost. That's obvious, of course, implicit and explicit, of course. Now, that's about supply. So the firm supplies as much as they can because there are various buyers in the market and they are the price taker. But now for the demands for the firm, you see in this diagram of this graph, so the yes, the demand curve from the firm is a horizontal curve. Thus, it's parallel with the horizontal axis. And you see that this characteristic is perfectly elastic demand curve. It means any change in the price of the firm's will lead to definite change in the quantity. And firms receive the same marginal revenue from the sale of each additional unit. So for each unit of products sold in the market, its role becomes the marginal revenues of the firm. So the firms will have marginal revenue equal price of the market. And we have the third notice here is the no limit to the total revenues that the firm can gain in the perfectly competitive market. It resulted from the assumptions of there are a large number of buyers in the market. So as long as the firm has the ability to produce product, they can sell it in the market. The market will observe only firm's quantity of production. And for maximization or minimize the maximization profit or minimization of the loss, we have total revenue and total cost approach. It means we have MR as equal MC in the conditions for maximization. That's why that means we compare the total revenue and total cost to find the levels of output that maximize the firm's profits or minimize the SEOs. And this is the condition. We have MR equal MC. It means the firm produces the levels unit. And so we have the marginal revenue equal price in the market. That's why from two conditions. First is MR equal NC, and the second is MR equal P. P is price. So we will have the in the markets, in the competitive markets, we'll have P equal NC. It means the price equal marginal cost is the point, is the condition for market for profit maximization. Now, from that condition, you will try and use the graph to show the economic profits of the firm for two cases. Case one is we have in the case we have a positive profit. And the other case we will see later is the case of a loss, because their decision is to maximize their profit or minimize their loss. So first, for the case of maximize their profit, how we can find the profits of the firm?
It's total revenue.
Yes, total revenue minus total cost.
Minus taxes and expenses.
Yes, minus the taxes and other expenses. And we assume that taxes and expenses will be included in the total cost. Okay, so the cost will be, because we have tax or other fees. Okay, can be classified as a relevant cost. So because they are relevant, they will be included in the total cost of the firm. So in general, we still have the total revenue minus total cost. And how to get the total cost? We can have a function of total cost. And total cost can be calculated from multiplying the average cost and quantity. Okay, we have an average cost for each product, and then we times with the quantity and it's the total cost. That's why in this graph you will see this offers rectangles. The areas of these actors of this upper rectangle is the economic profit, and the total revenues will be the areas of the largest rectangle here, because we take the price at this level and we time the quantity, and this is quantity. So this areas, the largest area is the revenue, and for total cost, you will see this point of these quantities of maximization of profit maximization. Suppose we have to decide at what output level the firm will reach maximum profit, and the conditions is marginal revenue equal marginal cost. So you will see that this marginal cost, this curve. Okay, this upward curve, and it will cross the marginal revenue, means the demand curve here, at this point, the point B. So from this point B, we decide the quantities of maximized profit maximization. So we also have this vertical line, has the IC curve cost. So at this point C. So C is the point that shows the average cost of the firm. And we take this average cost, yes, is equal to 77.3 in this case. And we take this as the average cost, and we multiply with quantity to get the total cost of the firm. So the rectangle is the quant is the amount of total cost of the firm, and we take the difference between these two areas, and we guess the economic profits of the firm. That's the case when the firm gets a profit. So, in summary, the first step to find deal with the pricing and output decisions of the firm. First step is to find the output, the levels of output maximization. Okay? So, it will happen in occur at the cross point of NC and MR. And then, from that, you decide the average cost of the firm, and then you find the total cost, you find the total revenue, and take the difference of the two, you will get the economic profit. That's how a firm can find their economic profit in the case of economics of competitive market. Now, if you notice, you will see the demand curve for the firms, for the competitive firms, is a horizontal line. Okay, so you see, it's a horizontal line. So it means it's parallel with the horizontal axis. That's the demand curve of the firm. How can you explain the forms of this curve? A horizontal demand curve. That's the demand curve of the firm. And is that the demand curve of the market? Now, what is the form of the demand curve of the market? Demand curve and supply curve. With the assumption that other things being equal, we have a demand curve. It's a downward sloping. Do you remember? Yes, demand curve is downward sloping. Demand curve and this supply curve, and we have a price in the vertical axis and quantity in the horizontal axis. And for most markets, we have these forms of supply and demand curve. So why for the firms of competitive market, the demand curve is a horizontal curve. It's a whole different. Now for the competitive firm, they are price taker. It means the price is unchanged. Yes. this part of their quantity of production and selling. Okay? So even the firms sell their product at the quantities of 1, 2, 3, or 8, the price is unchanged. That's why the price, their demand curve is a horizontal line at the point of the price, the market price. Okay? That's the demand curve for the firm. Okay? But for the market, the demand curve is still a vertical, it's a downward sloping demand curve. Okay? That's the difference. So you have to distinguish between the demand curve of the firm and the market's demand curve. Yes, the market is the demand curve of the firm, not the market's demand curve. Okay, only for the monopoly, we have only one firm operating in the market. So the firm is the industry. In that case, the firm's demand curve is a downward sloping line, okay? Because it's the same as the market's demand curve, but for competitive markets, it's different. Difference between the competitive firms and the market's demand curve, okay? So the demand curve for the competitive firm is a horizontal line as the price of the market. And that's why we will have demand curve. We have price equal MR and equal MC. Okay, and profit, you can see here, is the total revenues minus total cost. And we will split it in detail as the price charged minus average cost and times quantity. The second case is when the firms face economic loss. So, two decisions. First, to maximize their profit, and second is to minimize their cost, but their loss. This incurs when the firm has face the price, the market's price lower than its average cost. So the decision here is to stay the state of the market, continue with producing and selling, or shut down their business. So you see that the decision in this case depends on average variable cost. We do discuss about this last time. You see, that's whenever the price is higher than average variable cost, the firms can difference a part of the fixed cost. Okay? The firm is better off producing in the short run because it will still incur fixed costs greater than the loss. So when they maintain with the producing, the firms can defraze. Yes, in economics we use that term. We can defraze the part of the fixed cost. You gave examples of this case. Once a restaurant, they decide to continue with their doing business, or they shut down their business. And any the COVID, yes, we gave example about that case. Yes, they already signed a contract with the homeowners, and they have to pay their cost for hiring the facilities, or sometimes hiring worker, if they sign a maybe many years, some years contract instead of seasonal contract. Okay. So they still incur fixed cost, and so whenever they still doing business in the market, they can gain a part of the fixed cost. And so how much they can earn or they can minimize, in this case, you can see this the loss and this contributions to the fixed cost. Now, you remember that? Even if we do not show the fixed cost here, the difference between average cost and average variable cost is the fixed cost, is the average fixed cost. So this distance from AC and ABC is the fixed cost, average fixed cost, okay? And you, if you remember, the this distance seems to smaller when the firm gets a higher quantity of production. Why? So you see, the average fixed cost is the difference between average total cost, average total cost, or average cost and average variable cost. So the distance, this point and this point. And you see, these two curves tend to close with each other when the firm gets a higher level of production. It means the fixed cost and average fixed cost tend to reduce when the firms produce a larger number of their product. Why? Why? That's the basic knowledge, basic piece of knowledge of cost and production. Now the most important characteristic of fixed cost is
if you don't produce the products, the fixed cost is there.
Yes. So first even here, first that even if you do not produce product, you still the fixed cost still incur to your firm. And that's why. And the second characteristic is even if you produce a larger number of the product, the fixed cost is unchanged. So it do not vary with the numbers of products produced, okay? It's unchanged with the quantity of product. That's why when you produce, it's in total cost. So when you produce a larger number of product, the total cost, total fixed cost is unchanged. Do not vary with the increase of production. So the larger numbers of products you produce, the lower is the average fixed cost. Because the average fixed cost can be got from taking total fixed cost divided by the numbers of product. Okay? So that's why the AC and ABC tend to close with each other when the firm produces a larger number of products. As you see, this is the contribution. The column is the contribution margin. It's the amount by which the total revenue is this total variable cost. And the firms will continue with the production because they, in order to defray some of the fixed costs. So contributions to fixed costs. And the second case is the case of minimizing their loss. Yeah. And we have a shutdown point. Even when they face the loss, the loss is incurred for the firm, they will keep producing. But the key actions, the capital actions, is not continue forever. There still exists a point that the firm has to shut down. That's the shutdown point. That's the lowest price at which the firm will still produce. So, can you ask what is the point of shutdown? Take the price at higher level. And so making the profits of the firms alone higher than the case when the market is with the large numbers of suppliers. So if they can discover the market and become as the earlier company, so the newcomers at the time when the market is still have less potential, they will guess the national profit higher than the normal profit. As new firms enter the market, firms must find ways to produce as the lowest possible cost, or at least as cost level below those their competitors. So competitive is a good incentive for the firms to change their production technology or their production managerial skills. Because they are price taker, they cannot change the market price. And the only way to increase their marginal profit is to reduce their marginal cost. Okay? So marginal profits will equals marginal revenue minus marginal cost, and marginal revenue equals the price, market price. Okay, because they are price taker. So the only way to increase marginal profit is to reduce their cost. So they have a great incentive to reduce their cost in perfectly competitive market. So that's why, you see, in carries in implementations of the policy, of the competition policy, mainly the governments always want to make the markets become more competitive, because in that case, the firms have an incentive to make greater efforts to apply in modern technology, or to improve their managerial skills, or to train their employee to get higher levels of efficiency. Okay. So, and the last observation is the firm finds themselves unable to compete in the basis of court. They want to try to compete in the basis of product differentiation instead. So, they try to minimize their cost. But you see that cost includes in two parts, one's variable cost and the other fixed cost. So the limitations of reducing cost is the fixed cost. So this, in the ways, in case there are many competitors coming to the market, they have no ways to get their competitive advantage by reducing their cost. So in that case, they have to change the strategies from the cost minimization to the differentiation. So differentiation is always one of the best strategies for the firm, especially for small and medium-sized firm. These are the limitations of the resources. So that's the behaviors of the firm in competitive field. A perfect competitive market is quite common from one chain to another industry, this industry to another industry, from this country to other country. Okay. So, competing in the competitive market, the firm first try to enter as earlier as they can. And when they enter the market, they will try to reduce their cost. And when they reach the limitations of cost reduction, they will shift their strategy from the maximum cost, maximum minimization to the differentiation of their product. Okay, that's some point about the perfect competition. So, to understand more about the behaviors of firms in the perfect competition, can you make a summary some pieces of the firm in this market based on the market price. Can you? Based on market price and comparison with the firm's cost reduction. What can be the price of what's the decision of the firm? So the first decision is to decide the optimal output. Okay, optimal output. And optimal output for a competitive firm incur as the point when marginal revenue equal marginal cost. Okay, so first to decide optimal output, and then the decisions of continue or shut down. Yes, continue production or shut down. So when they will continue with their production. They will continue when level the market price is higher than average
cost.
Yes, exactly. Totally, exactly. They still continue with their business when level the price, the market price is higher than their average. Variable price, okay, and you can divide it into two sub cases. One is they get economic profits, and the others they minimize their loss. Okay, so for us, the price higher than the average variable cost, we have the first case. This one, the price is higher than average cost, okay. In that case, the firm gets a profit, okay, a positive profit. But when the price in the range of average cost and variable cost, okay, it's smaller than average cost, but it's higher than average variable cost, the firm will still continue in the market in short term to give rise the part of their fixed cost, okay? And only when the price is lower than average variable cost, they decide to shut down because they cannot offset any values of the variables or the fixed cost. Okay. That's now, do you have any question about this part? If you have no question, please do this exercise. Please do this exercise to really understand the theory.
Thank you.
to some exercise later. I don't know why as the reasons, but many of you seems sleeping.
Thank you. Hết rồi.
Yeah.